successful anti-grade recanalization of RCA. You have 6 minutes. Hello, sir.
Hello, I'm nice to see you.
The case I'm presenting is a 60-year-old male who had risk factors apart from age was hypertension. He had a history of anterior wall MI 3 months back and inferior wall MI 3 years back. He presented with symptoms of angina class 2 CCHS since 3 months and history of fatigue since last 2 to 3 years. Angio pictures I do not have, but angio revealed proximal LAD 100% and proximal RCA 100%. The symptoms were of angina were since the past 3 months and he had MI 3 months back. So I thought of opening up the LAD first. On assessment of the angio LAD, proximal LAD, the stump was blunt, but the CTO segment was small. The CTO segment was small, it was 10 millimeter, and there were retrograde collateral spilling from circumflex. I tried initially with a soft wire filter FC, couldn't get through. Then I just chose Gaia and went ahead. Gaia, I was able to successfully cross the lesion, and the lesion was stented with a, after pre-dilatation with 2.515 balloon, non-compliant. The lesion was stented with 3.018 Zion's prime stent, inflated up to 14 atmospheres. The lesion was post-dilated with a 3.5x15 NC balloon, inflated up to 14 atmospheres. This, after that, the patient still complained of fatigue, and that is when we decided to do the RCA. This is the RCA. There is a lesion in the proximal segment also 90%. After the occlusion in the mid segment 100%, the proximal cap of the CTO lesion is blunt. There are no bridging collaterals. The length was almost 50 millimeters. The distal vessel was clean and it was filling retrogradely from the LED. The plan was to go anti-grade for this. And if we were not successful anti-grade, then anti-grade dissection and re-entry. That was the plan. Guide support was initially not good with JR, so we took an anchoring balloon and then we were able to move with Gaia 1 wire. However, we were not able to cross the lesion initially with 1.2 balloon. And what happened while putting in the microcatheter, the wire got stuck in the microcatheter and had to be pulled out. And after trying for some more time, we could not go again. So we left during this time and went ahead after 4 weeks. This is the reattempt after 4 weeks. 4 weeks, this time we took an AR2 guide and the wire was again Gaia 1. We were able to cross it again after 4 weeks. This time we took check shoot from the left side also and confirmed the wire position distally. It was in the lumen. Then the lesion was pre-dilated with 1 mm x12 balloon at 12 atmosphere, followed by 1.5 x12, and then again 2.5 x15 balloons. This time the technique we had used was balloon assisted micro dissection, where one can go up even if the lesion is not crossing. We can go ahead and inflate the balloon to a point where it ruptures. It creates a micro dissection channel and allows a larger balloon to enter. This is the mechanism for that. After that, stent was implanted 2.75x48 distally, inflated up to 14 atmospheres, and 30-38 in the proximal segment, osteoproximal segment, inflated up to 16 atmospheres. However, what happened that the RV branch, which was patent up till now, closed after inflation of the second stent. And the patient had sinus arrest. We had to put in a temporary pacemaker wire. The sinus was resolved within the next 24 hours and patient recovered smoothly after that. The take home lessons from the case are, persistence is the key and one should know when to withdraw. If the wire is not crossing, one should not keep on doing it and creating more dissection channels. One may reattempt it after 4 weeks and have multiple plans ready if the balloon does not cross. Means small balloon, do grenadoplasty or have torsors ready. Good guide support is essential. Initially, the first time we had didn't have good guide support, we had to use anchoring balloon technique. Next time the guide was support was good with AR and we were able to do the case. Distal wire position should always be confirmed with strokes from the other side. Thank you.
Yeah. So good case, but when you have two CTOs, sometimes difficult to decide which to do first. I thought you had mentioned that the RCA was a chronic total occlusion.
Yeah.
So I guess if you had tried the RCA first and you were not successful, maybe you could have sent the patient for bypass surgery.
No, the history was like that the patient had gone to 3 tertiary centers for opinion, and everywhere he was advised CABG, and he said that he is not willing to do CABG.
That history was not forthcoming. So, but in a case like this, is better you try the CTO first. If you're not successful, then CABG is an option.
Okay. Few comments. One is that you said it's a blunt stump in your diagnostic, but I think the RCA had a small nipple at the bottom. So I think in the classification it falls under the JCTO1 rather than blunt stump. The other thing is that that 112 balloon. What was that balloon? 1 millimeter into 12.
Tazuna.
Okay, fine. Okay. And you said the wire got stuck in the microcatheter. Wire got stuck. How did that happen? Just, I mean, out of curiosity, I'm asking. How did that?
Actually, because of financial constraints, the microcatheter was Oxford.
Okay. No, but the wire went through first, right? Okay, you could not differentially remove the microcatheter with the wire inside. That's what you are saying. Okay, fine. Okay. Sure. Great
rewire.
Case.
Why
did
you rewire it?
Yeah, I tried rewiring it. We were not successful. That is why we attempted it 4 weeks later. Probably a dissection plane. Probably a dissection plane was created.
Yeah, because when you started doing your right CTO, I can't see any left sided injections.
No, he had not taken left injections till after he crossed.
Yeah.
So that's one more golden rule.
You should have, even before you start the procedure, you should
that's
have
a golden rule
injection.
That you always take bilateral injections.
I agree, any CTO.
It's not there, but I have shown in the second one that the left side shoots are there in the second one.
The golden rule in CTOs, you need to have bilateral
injections. You
have access.
It before you cross.
Rather than take it in the middle of the procedure. Thanks for your presentation.
Thank you.
I will invite the
nice
next
case.
Presenter, Rupali Khanna, to present the case.
Good morning, everyone. I will be presenting one case. He was a 50-year-old gentleman with a risk factor of smoking. He presented with class 2 exertional angina for past 2 years with recent worsening of recurrent rest anginas for past 3 days. His ECG was showing normal sinus rhythm with right bundle branch block, but there were some primary STT changes, if you can see, V3, V4, and LVDPA, and his stroke was elevated of 3.2. His echo was of normal function with no regional wall abnormality. So with making a diagnosis of exertional angina for past 2 years and with recent non-ST MI, we took the patient for angio. So this was his basal angio. We did through the right radial artery route. The left main was normal and LCX and ramus was normal, but LAD after giving a big diagonal, we were not able to see distally. There was a filling defect in the proximal part of LAD and the distal LAD and the mid part of LAD was not visible. His RCA was dominant with free of significant disease and we can see a very faint collaterals through the septal filling the distal part of the RCA. It was just a grade 2-1 collaterals. So assuming that it's a thrombotic occlusion because we were seeing the filling defect in the RCA in the proximal part at the level of the septal, we thought it's a recent occlusion and we proceeded with your angioplasty. So we took a 7 French EBU catheter and we wired the diagonal and did the thrombosuction in hope that we might see the distal part or the stump of the LAD where it is occluded. But to our surprise, we were not able to see the LAD stump. There was no distal filling of LAD and we just after thrombus removal, it was completely blunt. So the LAD stump could be at the level of the septal or it could be just distal part of the septal. So we don't know where to poke our wire. So now we thought we are dealing with a CTO case. The difficulties which we were facing were that there was no stump, it was completely blunt. There was a big side branch at the occlusion and the CTO length was more than 20 millimeter because the distal collateral filling was very faint and we were not able to have the distal vessels, so no good collaterals, but there we can go for retrograde. But the positive points were there was no bridging collaterals plus a side branch. Now how can a side branch can be a good for doing a CTO? If we have a flush occlusion of the CTO segment and if there is a big side branch, we can take a help of an IVUS and do an anti-grade proximal cap penetration. So this IVUS can help us in localizing the plaque stump or where there is a sweet spot on the angiogram and we can penetrate this stump with the help of the IVUS. So we did the same thing. We wired our diagonal and did the pullback from the diagonal to localize the proximal LAD stump. So if you can see the IVUS, at the 10 o'clock, 2 o'clock position, we can clearly see a LAD stump which was arising. And if you see, this was the part on the angio which we can see the LAD stump at 2 o'clock. So this was the IVUS image. We fixed our IVUS catheter at the level of the LAD stump localization at the 2 o'clock and we can see the septal at 5 o'clock position. So we plan to go for a live IVUS wiring of the LAD. We took a fine cross catheter with a Concus Pro wire and keeping the IVUS at the position where we were able to see the LAD stump, we planned a manipulated our wire to enter the LAD stump. As you can clearly see, the movement of the LAD wire, the Concus Pro, and entering into the LAD stump. So this IVUS guided wiring helped us to localize the LAD proximal stump and we were able to enter the LAD. Then the distal wire, for the distal wiring, we just advanced our microcatheter and we were able to do the distal course of wiring guided by the retrograde injection. And then the wire was changed and then we did a normal balloon dilatation and two stents were implanted of 2.538 and 334 drug eluting stents in LAD. So the common reason for failure of CTO radicalization is inability to cross the guide wire and this abrupt CTO blunt stumps with a big side branch are the poor predictors. But if you do a live IVUS guide wiring usual, we can have a proper entrance of the wire without entering the subintimal region and our success rate can be increased. Thank you.
A nice case, IVUS guided CTO recanalization. I think it was well done.
Yeah, well done. I think the key here was the IVUS guidance and the point to remember is if you look at the angiogram casually, you might even miss the LAD. You might think it's a small LAD and leave it.
Yeah, and you might think that the diagonal is the LAD.
Yeah, yeah. And even more interesting is why the LAD was not filling in the diagnostic angiography. If it had been a true CTO, it should have been filling to some extent because it's such a big LAD.
Yeah.
And it was surprising that it was not filling retrogradely. but it was
just the distal part which you were able to see.
Yeah, it was well done. Well done.
Any comments on the floor? We have 1 minute for. Thank you.
I understand the wiring by fibers.
Can I put my slides, please?
Now the basic principle in that is you have a flush occlusion of LED origin at the point where the diagonal starts. So you don't know where that point is. So either you can poke around blindly to wait for the wire to catch somewhere. That is what we usually try first. If you don't have a point where the wire catches, then you have nothing to do. Either you go retrogradely, or if you have a big enough diagonal, like in this case, you park the IVUS in the diagonal. Now, when you do a pullback, you can see the LED origin. Even if it is occluded, it's seen in IVUS. So then you place the IVUS sensing point, like how they've placed exactly where the LED is supposed to be. Then you, as your IVUS is running live, you try to wire it. You had an animation, a diagram.
Yes.
That explains that better.
So actually what we do is basically we place the IVUS just at the diagonal where we are able to see the mouth of the LED. So after seeing the LED mouth, we take usually a penetrating wire and try to redirect towards the IVUS at which angle we are able to see the LED. So at this point, suppose this is an animated picture, at 2 o'clock we are seeing the LED. We try to redirect our penetrating wire so that it enters that LED stump and we then advance our microcatheter. So we are sure that we are entering that in my angio, I can just show you in my IVUS. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Can you see at 12 o'clock there is one hyperechoic shadow? 12 o'clock, and then there is a movement.
Okay.
12 o'clock, 1 o'clock.
Yeah, yeah.
So that wire is just the wire which is in the microcatheter, that's a penetrating wire, and we try to redirect it so that it enters the. So if you see the red arrow, you can see that the wire is trying to enter at the red arrow and it then successfully enters the stump. So we have to be sure that we enter to the. Yeah, that's the wire which entered. So we have to be sure that we don't enter the subintimal part, we enter the inside the true lumen of that.
That part was not clear. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, we use the Boston. Yes.
When you have this stump occluded, and especially when you're doing RCA, then probably this Boston IVUS doesn't
work. Yes,
then
Boston actually the tip diameter
because
is
it has end tip wire.
The tip length is actually for 26 mm. So that in that cases,
but then Volcano would help with the.
Yes, end tip, but Volcano will probably that the image quality is not so good as.
For IVUS guided entry, if there's a flush occlusion and there's no big side branch where you could get the wire down. Get the IVUS down, the Volcano.
Then in that case, Volcano. But for this, the prerequisite having a big side branch.
She's actually used the side branch to her advantage. Normally, it's an adverse predictor of failure to cross a CTO when you have a side branch and a blunt stump. But using IVUS, she has used the side branch to advantage in crossing her lesion.
So it works both ways. It's like occluding the side branch with the balloon, plus you have guidance. The catheters wise, I think the Boston one has 20 millimeters from the two markers. The current thermo one has 2.9 millimeters. So that's a very, very short tip that you can, even if you cannot enter the side branch too much, you can just park it there and you can still use it.
Yeah, actually we don't have thermo.
We don't have it in India yet.
Yes.
If you have too many hardware, then can you keep it for a long time?
Yeah. Normally you keep checking your ACT, no? In a CTO like this.
But usually just after penetration.
No, that's why we take a 7 French or an 8 French guide.
Yeah, we took a 7 and French and after penetration, we just try to remove the IVUS so that we don't keep, because the IVUS will help only till the proximal cap penetration. After distal wiring, IVUS won't help much.
And the guidelines are like, for example, when you're doing a normal angioplasty, you're checking your ACT maybe 45 minutes, 1 hour. For this, you have to check your ACT every 20 minutes. Every 20 minutes.
Yeah. So ACT has to be.
No, in fact, when you do a CTOs, you will have microcatheters, you will have corsairs, you have trapping balloons. That's the reason you have to check your ACT every 20 minutes in CTOs.
Then go to the next case. We have the Nimit Shah present this case.
good morning, friends. So I'll present a case with a retrograde CTO. If I can move forward. Yeah, so this was a gentleman. He was 70-year-old, previous CABG, and he present with unstable angina, increased frequency of angina, diabetes, and this was his angiogram. He had a RCA CTO, which was reattempted twice in different center, and then he presented to me. So if you look at his left-sided shot, this is the left main, which has got a very critical calcified distal left main lesion. This is a cranial view, where you see the LED coming here, and then you see a faint septal going down over here. This is an RCA CTO with a lot of bridges here, bridging collaterals, and then you can see the distal filling down over here. This is a Lima shoot, which guides us very well. So if you see this Lima to LED, back filling, and then you see the septal coming here, and this septal is giving good collaterals to the RCA. So the understanding of angiogram is very important. So what information I have got here is I've got an RCA CTO, which is quite long, bridging collaterals. I don't have a defined stem there, but there is a distal filling. From this view, which is a cranial view, there's a septal coming here, but I cannot see much over here, probably because of the lesion in the left main. But if you look at the Lima shoot, the septal is quite good, and it gives quite long septal and gives good collaterals to the right. So what we planned is, we thought going to the Lima would be quite a long, quite be tedious, and it's not without any risk if you have to do a retrograde. So the plan was to navigate the left system from the left coronary artery. So we took a EBU, 7-8 French EBU, 3.5. We wired into the diagonal, then did a rotor ablation of the left main. So this is the rotor of the left main. And this is a picture of the rotor. You can see the septal is more clearer. What you were seeing with Lima, you can now see with the anterograde injection through the left coronary system. So this is now the septum. You can see very clearly the septal and the cross filling to the right. So once we did that, then we used the corsair, navigate the septum with the cyan wire. First we took a workhorse wire into the septum, then placed the corsair over here, changed for a cyan wire, then we surfed the septum. Again, it was in a wrong direction over here. We pulled the corsair back, we did a tip injection, and you see the tip injection showing the septals very well. Then again the surfing of the septal with the cyan wire. You see quite a bend over here, but traveled very nicely. Then you can see the septal has come up to the distal cap, and this is a corsair that we have advanced further through the septal. So this is a corsair coming up to the distal stump. Then we knuckled the distal wire, so we changed the cyan wire. Once the corsair was up to the distal stem, we changed to a Pilot 200. And we knuckled it retrogradely. Then we took an antegrade injection. This is the first injection after we did all the retrograde surfing and knuckling. Then we took again a corsair antegradely, and we took a fine filter XT wire, and we knuckled it antegradely. If you see, this is the knuckle from the retrograde. This is the knuckle here from the antegrade, and there's a balloon here. So then we did a reverse cut. We externalized the wire through an RG3 wire. And then we started ballooning from the antegrade. So that was the antegrade injections after the ballooning. Then we deployed 3 stents starting from here. And that was the final result. So in summary, it is like, you know, for you have to understand the anatomy very well. Think outside the box. So rotator ablation to that left main helped to, you know, make the septal artery more prominent, and then you could do a retrograde CTO using a reverse cock. Thank you.
It's a very good case, but you do make it look very complicated, you know. How about trying the RCA anti-grade first?
It was tried twice before.
No, but you didn't try it. It was
in we tried as well in our center. We had tried.
So you tried it yourself?
We tried it. So before going retrograde, we would at least give 5 to 10 minutes of anti-grade wiring before we go to retrograde. But if you look at the RCA, and there were good collaterals, right? So if you look at the algorithm, if there's a long CTO, you have a stem, there are bridging collaterals, you don't have a clear stem, you can go as a retrograde as a primary intervention as well, if you look at the hybrid algorithm.
Yeah, that's the algorithm, but I think 5 to 10 minutes is a too short a period for trying anti-grade. That's the Japanese advocacy that I know. But I think many cases that I have thought it we will fail anti-grade but still gave it a shot has succeeded. Especially in a case like this where you have such a bad left main and you had to do a rotator to just to get a retrograde, an anti-grade try for a longer duration, maybe.
A good anti-grade try,
instead of a short casual try.
The operator who had tried, he was my mentor as well. So
I agree.
Anti-grade before, then the case came to me. Other option I would have tried is I would have used a crosshair, crossbars. Because a long CTO, there was a good distal landing zone. I could have an anti-grade.
Yeah, this is a case for a crossbox.
Yeah.
Anti-grade.
So that was also
anti-grade,
But crossbox, if there is little bit of calcification also, it really doesn't go so well.
No, it would go. Calcification into the true lumen, but crossbox, if you are sub-interval.
Sub-interval is okay. Yeah.
It would go very nice.
Sub-interval, it would go.
So this is also, crossbox would be for dissection re-entry. So you go into the sub-interval, pass your distal occlusion and then re-enter using a stingray balloon and sting wire.
So for the knuckle, would you prefer a pilot 200 kind of wire or a softer hydrophilic wire?
So these are the two wires recommended for knuckle, which is pilot 200 and filter XT.
Okay.
These are the two wires recommended for knuckling.
Personally, I would prefer a softer wire, especially when you are coming a retrograde knuckle. Because once or twice I've got stuck after the knuckling, could not remove the wire. Because it formed an acute bend at the tip of the microcatheter, we could not pull it back into the microcatheter. Fielder the wires are little more forgiving to pull back. So that's a word of caution. That's excellent case.
The case well done, very well done.
Thank you.
I think we'll.
Bilateral injection through the LED to see the segment, how much is the occluded segment? Because when your retrograde wire went there, I don't think it was more than 30 mm anti-grade and the retrograde wire. So was there any injection which was done through the Lima and the RCA bilateral?
Yeah, we had that roadmap through the Lima, and when we kept on, see, I've not put all the shots over
okay.
here. So once we did the rotor and we found that the septal was, you know, we could see the...
No, before the rotor, I'm asking. Through the Lima, did you check that what is the total length?
And we knew where the diagonal was, where the septal was. So we knew where we were.
I'm talking about the RCA occlusion, the total length. Did you do a simultaneous injection before that?
Because, if you look at the...
Even without doing the simultaneous, the anti-grade injection showed the length of the occlusion.
Yeah, that was it. Because I think the anti-grade stump was not blunt. We can see
a
tip.
The bridging collateral.
Bridging collateral was there.
Very difficult. A lot of bridging collateral.
Thank you. It's a very good case. We'll go to the next presenter. Is the next presenter around? Mr. Rajendran? Yeah.
Good morning, everyone. I have attempted a few CTOs on my own and failed a few, and this is one thing I succeeded, and I have some few learning points from this for myself. And my case was a 56-year-old diabetic male who had dyspnea of class 3 to 4 for almost 6 months to 1 year, with recurrent admissions with decompensated heart failure, then ejection fraction as low as 27%. Has been treated as dilated cardiomyopathy, though the LV was showing only a mild dilatation of the LV. And each time during his decompensation, you might have a reversible increase in the creatinine that gets normal after admission and some minor tropes and recovery. There was no history of MI from the history, and the ECT was also showing some poor progression of our wave, otherwise it was looking normal. And this was from the during the intervention, it shows almost diffusely diseased LED with most of the filling happening from the right side. On the left side injection do show some flow up to the septal, but there is no anti-grade connection. So the run-through wire loaded in a Corsair microcatheter was up to the proximal cap where the run-through failed to advance was placed over that point. Then using a Fielder XT, I was probing for the microchannel. It was getting buckling repeatedly, but I could successfully probe a channel that is little more to the right of this original wire course. But subsequently the Corsair was failing to advance, and luckily I routinely take a fine cross. In this case it was a Corsair, that was the only catheter that was available with me, and it helped me by as it was braided I could screw it in and advance into the distal LED after checking in the true lumen. But before I could exchange into a run through wire or the workhorse wire, it got pulled back, but the track created by the Corsair allowed me to rewire without much difficulty. So after serial dilatations with a 2x15 balloon, I could see the LED till the distal end, so it's diffusely diseased. I tried to take a 3x48. I wanted to stent the proximal first, so 3x48 stent failed to advance after the proximal segment, as you could see. So in spite of repeated attempts, when the stent came out, I could see the rapid exchange spot is kinked. So I left it over and then took a guideliner, and through the guideliner I was trying to advance this 3x44mm stent now. So even after there are some clips missing here, after placing the guideliner as distal as possible, when I was advancing the stent into the guideliner, it was not negotiating the arch of the aorta, and that was not even coming out into the coronary part, and it again got completely the rapid exchange section was completely kinked and overlapped into two layers when I took it out. So this time what I did, I tried to advance the first 48mm stent itself to the maximum point to where it goes, and over that I advanced the guideliner to my desired point, and now I could able to advance the stent. Then after positioning in the caudal segment at the ostium, I was able to deploy the stent successfully, and then the distal vessel was too small, so I took a 2.5 28mm this time a Navarrolimus saluting stent that too crossed with difficulty due to wire bias at the proximal edge of the stent, and subsequently I under deployed and ended up an expansion of the distal edge, for which I had to take another balloon and dilate it to get the result. So it ended up stenting from all the way from the ostium to the distal LED. And one thing I could notice here is, though the collaterals from the RCA was giving a lot of micro channels, none of them are actually filling anti-gradely through the stents. But the patient actually improved over next 2-3 days. And the post procedure, he had developed sepsis secondary to thrombophlebitis. He had a very stormy course. I thought he might not survive, but his symptoms gradually improved everything, and the EF also improved. Now at the 1.5 months follow, he's walking normally. So whatever I could get out of this case is that seemingly it was a DCMP, but had an ischemic etiology. And the critical steps, I usually go radial, but here I took a 7F through the femoral that allowed me for easy manipulation. Obviously dual injection is a must here, and the Corsair facilitated crossing and easy exchange of wires, and it overcomes at least 40% of balloon uncrossable lesions. And the guideline might, stents might fail to take the curve of the guideliner in the aortic arch, and gliding the guideliner over the stent, and then the stent worked. So the clinical improvement is remarkable and was rewarding. Thank you.
So in a case of presence of heart failure and severe LVAD dysfunction, normally you have a viability assessment and either a cardiac MRI or a perfusion scan.
First thing I couldn't do that is the facilities is not available. And the second thing is patient is not.
And second, the RCI, if you look carefully, you had a mid RCI was a
stenosis. Yes, the disease.
And if you in the dictum in patient who present ischemic cardiomyopathy of this kind is to have a complete revascularization rather than just attempt one vessel and open up whatever vessels are possible, or send the patient for surgery. But here you have a incomplete revascularization, a patient who had severe LVAD dysfunction. Is that acceptable? Is the question.
I don't think the LAD could be grafted here, sir, because
not a question of grafting. What about the RCA?
The RCA actually, it was planned for a complete revascularization, but the end of the procedure was the blood pressure was too low and the duration was too long, and the creatinine was also on the higher side. So I was actually planning for a staged procedure, but he had a stromy coast in the post procedure period. So actually, he is waiting for the staged procedure now. Luckily, he's doing well at this point of time.
Technically, I think the LAD looked quite simple. I think it's okay to have tried angioplasty as the first choice, since the LAD looked like a simpler case.
And multiple channels were there.
Few comments is that the run-through wire is not a hydrophilic wire. Only the run-through hypocote is a hydrophilic wire. And most of the times, I think the first choice of the wire should be a hydrophilic wire, because that tracks channels much better instead of a routine, you know, spring coiled wire.
I used it just to take the microcatheter till the proximal cavity.
Okay.
And then I
that's fine.
It to a
that's fine.
XT.
That no. You had said that you tried and then changed it to a Fielder XT. That's why I said that. And once you get the Corsair across, it's always better to get a Grand Slam or an Ironman wire, so that you have solid support, because you may not get that opportunity again. Once you put a softer wire and everything comes out, especially you had multiple dissections in the LAD, then you are in deep trouble. So always put a stiff wire so that you have the rock support. And you can also consider putting a wire in the circumflex when your stent did not track before attempting guideliner. Two, three wires, even put another buddy wire in the LAD. You know, those are cheaper options and usually works. Your stent was getting stuck somewhere in the mid LAD, right?
Yes.
And you were planning for a 3 stent. So you can also dilate with the 3 balloon.
Yeah. I did everything actually. I dilated a 3 balloon and then I tried to stent again. That was not going. And then through the guideliner when I took the stent, the stent also got crushed.
Okay.
So I advanced the stent as much as possible, and over that I took the guideliner.
Yeah, that was an excellent demonstration of how to push the guideliner over the stent.
Yes.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Very nice case, very well, and very good results as well. First, as you rightly said, like if I was also do the same thing after the Corsair, I would get a Grand Slam. Sometime you might not need a guideliner or a guide sealer. Secondly, do you know why was your stent getting stuck in the arch of aorta?
It's just across the arch, just from the arch to the descending aorta.
And why was it getting stuck?
I'm not sure.
Because the guide sealer has a mouth. Right, so it's a metal, a guideliner. It is a metal mouth. So when your stent, you have to screen when the stent is going up.
Yeah.
So it was hitting against the metal.
Yeah.
Right. So that you have to just manipulate. Probably that's the reason it is getting stuck, because it's all the metal sleeve. Secondly, you said you pass the guidezilla or guideliner over the stent. Sometimes it can damage the stent. The best thing or best tricks are you get the balloon down.
Yeah.
Over the balloon shaft, you get the guidezilla, which is more. Safer.
That's what I did actually. I couldn't demonstrate that. That's what routinely I do, because I'm worried to take the guideliner over the stent or over the wire itself. So I put the balloon in the mid LED. I took the guideliner up to the mid LED. Once the guideliner was there, I took the stent across, and this stent, after entering the proximal part of the guideliner across the arch, it was not advancing at all. and I true screened it, and then when I was screening and pushing it, my hand is moving in, but the stent edge is not moving in. All those things are not stored
because of that. As I said, it's a metal mouth. It's a metal mouth.
Probably I come across this. So, and then when I took it out, although the first stent which had a kink is the one which I deployed ultimately. The second stent, the 45mm stent which I took inside, that was get caught in the guide liner, had almost kinked and became a double layer thing. When I extended it, it was in two pieces in my
because
hand.
It was hit against the metal struck and it has fractured the stent. So,
okay.
So that's the reason if you find, so when you take a guide liner, you have to go very slowly and you screen it. If there's any resistance, you screen the arch and see whether your stent is moving or not. Otherwise, you end up damaging the stent.
Yeah. And is there a way to overcome it without whatever I have employed here?
No, you did the fail. Means you did very well.
Thank you.
So the only other point is you said you were moving your hand and the stent was not moving, right? This happens when your guide is, you know, snaking in the aorta below that, which you don't see. So again, a long sheath, a 45mm sheath will avoid that. Yeah.
Complex C2 interventions in retroviral positive patients, challenges and dilemmas. I have three cases. First case presented with a 38-year-old male presented with history of effort angina since 4 months, dyspnea since 2 months, NIH class 2. No past medical history of coronary artery disease, no family history of coronary artery disease or sudden cardiac death in the family. He is not a smoker, diabetic and hypertensive. Was detected to have HIV 6 months ago and is on heart therapy. His complete blood counts are normal, CD3 and CD4 counts are 390. ECG revealed old anterior myocardial infarction QRBP pattern. Echocardiography revealed a regional wall motion abnormality, ejection fraction is 30%. CAG revealed LMC 90% stenosis, LAD osteoproximal total occlusion, LCS osteoproximal 90% lesion, RC osteop 90% lesion. Thought to be a LMC, TVD and severe LV dysfunction referred for surgery for further management. But patient not willing for surgery, relatives are not unwilling for surgery. Then planned for multivessel PCA. This is the horiocaudal sheath, the LMC severely diseased and LAD is totally occluded, circumflex is 90% lesion. And LA cranial shows LMCA disease, LAD total occluded, RCA, osteoproximal RCS, tightly stenosed. Then we did 3-40 drug evaluation deployed to RCA with 3.5 to 10 with non-compliant balloon post dilated. After completion of the RCA procedure, then plan for left system. As you have tried to obtain in just 35 to 40 minutes with multiple wires, as soon as they enter the whisper wire, patient developed severe hypotension, unstable on table. Then plan to abort the procedure. Then again, you have 5-10 minutes to wait to disengage the catheter, then finish the quickly procedure. With the whisper, we crossed, successfully crossed with the whisper wire to LAD and the cougar wire to circumflex. Pre dilated with 2.5 to 12 with the sphincter balloon LAD and 2.5 to 15 with the sphincter balloon to circumflex. Simultaneously deployed the LAD and circumflex stents. 2.74 24 drug to the L circumflex and 3-24 drug to LAD. Then post dilated with 3.210 and 3.412 with simultaneously kissing. This is the final results. Post procedure, he was monitored 48 hours in the coronary care unit. And the patient discharged with stable condition. 6 months follow-up, he is asymptomatic, LV improved to 45% and is on dual antiplatelets and heart therapy. Coming to Motor's second case, a 40-year-old male presented with history of effort angina since 7 months, past medical history of coronary artery disease and status post PTSD to LADs 2 years back, but no records are available. No family history of coronary artery disease, sudden cardiac death in the family. Patient is a smoker, non-diabetic and not drug abused. Patient is a known retroviral positive since 2 years and was on heart therapy. His complete blood count was normal, CD3, CD4 count were 450, ECG revealed STT changes in the anterior chest lead, TMT positive 6 METs, echo cardium revealed regional wall motion abnormality, ejection fraction 50%. MPI is suggestive of individual ischemia in the LID territory. RCA dominant normal in RVA cranial wood shows the mid of the LMC and distal LMC is severely diseased and the osteoproximal LID is totally occluded with ISR of 100%. In PA cranial also distal LMC at mid LMC is 90% lesion and LID is totally occluded. You have planned with IVUS guided. Then you finally succeeded one pilot wire cross successfully with the LID and the cougar wire tracer complex. And 2.5 15 sphincter bone sequentially dilated distal to the proximal. And 3 into 48 the guillotines deployed distally. And proximally 3 into 38 the guillotines deployed and overlapped with the distal stent. And post dilated with the 3 into 10 and 3.5 into 10 and 4 into 10 with post-dilatation with non-compliant balloon. This is the final results of LAD. And RDO caudal view, this is LA caudal view. The patient was discharged with stable condition 6 months follow-up. During follow-up, he was asymptomatic, is on dual antiplates and heart therapy. Moving to third case, a 36-year-old male presented with history of aphantine angina since 1 year. No past medical history of coronary artery disease. No family history of coronary artery disease, sudden cardiac death in the family. Patient is not a smoker, diabetic and drug abuse. Patient was detected with HIV incidental. Complete blood counts are renal for liver function normal. CT3, CT4 very low, 220. ECG revealed old inferior myocardial infarction. Echocardiogram revealed regional wall motion abnormality. Ejection fraction 45%. Myocardial perfusion imaging suggestive. There is a reversible inducible ischemia seen in the RCA territory. The proximal RCA is totally occluded. In RVA cranial also totally occluded with proximal RCA. They have taken left system is normal, collateral is well seen in the left injection. Then is almost equal to 2 to 2.5 hours. We finally succeeded with the Fielder FC wire process successfully RCA. Then sequentially pre-dilated with 2 into 15 and 2.5 into 15 balloon. Distally 3 into 48 regulating system deployed distally. And approximately 3 to 38 drug regulation was deployed. And 3 to 38 into deployed proximally. We post dilated with the non compliant balloon 3.5 to 10 and 3.5 to 10. Program distal to sequential and distal to the proximal. The final results of this is the final results. The patient was discharged in stable condition 6 months follow-up. Again, during follow-up, he was asymptomatic. He is on dual antiplatelets and heart therapy. Coming to what about learning? What was the learning with the challenges and decision-making and management of patients infected with HIV presented with aphantine angina and complex CTO? Chronic total occlusion, percutaneous coronary intervention should be performed within a structured framework in a robust procedural planning. In a day-to-day practice, HIV-infected patients are usually refused for CABG, and patients with suitable coronary anatomy, high surgical risk may be considered for multivessel PCI as a safe and effective alternate to CABG. HIV status and heart therapy did not interfere with the revascularization approach or clinical outcome. Retropositive patients emphasize the concern about specific preventive recommendation that should be followed during the interventional procedure performance, which involves the handling of needles and related materials.
Yeah, all three cases are well done. But the first case, you know, the RCA occlusion and critical left main with LV dysfunction.
Yeah.
I would have prophylactically put IABP when planning such a complex intervention.
As soon as the LID was crossed, you developed hypotension.
That's what. You can expect hypotension in a patient like
that. With thyroid support of BPS, it's improved
to understand. No, you don't understand what I'm telling. What I'm trying to say is, before you start the procedure,
prophylactic,
put IABP first. That will make the procedure more stable.
Yeah.
Otherwise, in between the procedure, you develop hypertension, you have to abort, or you have a cardiac arrest. The second case, you had a diffuse instant reconnaissance of the LAD. Do you have IVUS or OCT?
No, I was guided with plan. Yes, I was guided.
You didn't do IVUS?
I was guided, we did.
It was IVUS guided, okay, that's right. So the first stent was partially.
Yeah, taken. Because of the records on which stent is done, which stent you
know, was
any records for that.
Was the previous stent under deployed or was it on the IVUS?
2 years back, yeah, procedure PDC.
Now what were the findings on IVUS in that patient?
Findings, yeah, because of the LID, LMCA, mid and distal LMC is diffusely diseased. There was a tight stenosis. Then after the wiring, completely successfully with the wire, LID wire, then you completed the procedure with IVUS guided.
All right.
Okay. The first case, why did you choose an SKS? It could have been just a T because the angle was quite almost 90 degrees, LAD circumflex. Why did you choose a SKS over?
Because it's presented with effort angina, 6 months, one is 7 1 year, and one is TMT positive, and we did MPA inducible ischemia in the territory, LAD territory, RCI territory.
No, he's asking.
No, no, I'm asking about the LAD circumflex bifurcation technique. We could have easily put a stent in the LCX and then stented left main to LAD instead of doing a two stents coming into the double barrel in.
On table, you have to quickly finish the procedure that you have taken decision because on table has become unstable.
Okay.
That is the one.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. Nice cases.
Nice case.
Thank you.
We'll call the last presenter.
So now we, HIV is one more indication for PCI over CABG. Yeah. Does that apply to hepatitis C and hepatitis B? Surgery. Do they do for hepatitis B and hepatitis C? No, no. HCV is supposed to be worse than HIV as of today. So do they refuse HCV also? I'm just asking, curiosity. Yeah.
Respected Chairperson and dear colleagues, good morning to all. My case is a 45-year-old gentleman who is a smoker, non-diabetic, non-hypertensive. Had a history of anti-AMI about a year and a half back, was managed outside conservatively, and now present to us with history of class 2 angina for last 6 months, which progressed to class 3 for last 2 months on optimal medical therapy. He had borderline systolic function with an ELA ejection fraction of 50-55%, who was taken up for angiography. In angiography, we can see the shaft of the left main distal part had eccentric lesion, and distal left main is diseased. The osteoproximal part of LAD is diseased, and there is a proximal LAD CTO with a bridging collateral and also a collateral from the proximal LCX. The distal RC is being filled from the left injection. We can see the collaterals to the distal RC. And the osteoproximal part of the L6 is also diseased, and OM is the dominantly supplying the more area from the L6 side. RCA is diffusely diseased from the proximal to the distal part. There is tight stenosis in the mid part of the RCA, and the distal part of the RCA is totally occluded. And there are good collaterals from the conal branch to the LAD and also from the RV branch to the LAD. So with this anatomy, our options and approach, what were our thoughts were that there is a shaft of the left main diseased with significant stenosis in the osteoproximal LAD and a CTO in the proximal part of LAD, and LCX has osteal disease, and RCA is refused diseased with a CTO in the distal part of the RCA and a high in syntax score. So patient was advised CABG, but the patient was reluctant to undergo the CABG despite he had financial constraints. So we decided to take him for multivessel PCI. So our thought process was that he has two major vessels CTO with left main bifurcation disease. Now we thought that whether to do RCA first or LAD left main bifurcation first. We thought that RC is probably the culprit lesion for recent worsening of symptoms, and L6 was the only surviving branch as such. So if we do LEPIN first, probably if we do some problem to the L6, patient may have problem. So we decided that we'll stent the RCA first and then go for a staged procedure for left main bifurcation and LAD CTO. So in stage one, we decided to revascularize RCA. So we took a right femoral approach, 7 French sheath and 6 French JR 3.5. And as soon as we hooked the RCA, the patient had some hemodynamic compromise, probably because the coronal branch was supplying good collateral to the LAD and probably there was some compromise of the flow. So we managed it putting the TPI, we kept the TPI in IVC and managed with it inotropes and IV fluids, and patient improved and then subsequently wired it with the Fielder XT wire. So we were able to wire, but there was little problem with the guide support, was not good. So since patient had some hemodynamic compromise, we quickly dilated it with 215 balloon proximally, but we could not cross this balloon distally. So for distal dilatation, we took 1.25 into 10 balloon and subsequently 2 into 15 balloon and serial dilatation were given. And TV2 flow was achieved in distal RCA with the dissection in the distal RCA. So far so good, but at this point of time, patient had some cough and some movement, and we lost the wire from the distal RCA and exactly before the dissection. At this point of time, we tried to recross the distal RCA, but we struggled a bit with various wires. We took Fielder XT, already was there, and we took Sion Blue, but we were not able to cross. And after few minutes, patient developed no flow, acute vessel closure in the distal RCA, and hemodynamic instability. Again, it was managed with the inotropes and IV fluids, but luckily we were able to again recross with new Fielder XT wire. And then we dilated the RCA with 2.5 into 15 and quickly stented it. Unfortunately, the videos are not going, but the whole RCA was stenting from distal to proximal, and this was the final result of RCA. And then second stage, we decided to do the PCI to LAD CTO and left main bifurcation. Again, at this time, we took 7 French guide with JL 3.57 French guide catheter and Fielder XT wire, ASD wire. So I think the videos are not going. So again here we tried to cross with the Fielder XTA wire, but initially we were not able to cross, but then we took the balloon support, and with the help of balloon support of 1.25 into 6, we were able to cross the wire to the distal LAD. And the lesion was pre-dilated first with 1.25 balloon and then subsequently with 2.5 into 15 balloon. The distal and mid part of the LAD was stented with two drug-eluting stents, and then subsequently we planned for the left main bifurcation stenting. So we wired L6OM as well as L6. So since the OM branch was the dominant branch, so we decided to stent towards OM1. With the mini crush as the technique, doing by a step crush. So we kept one balloon in the left main to LAD and put a stent from the ostium of the LCX with minimal protrusion into the left main. And after deployment, this stent was crushed with the balloon that was kept in the left main to the LAD. And following this, we decided to stent from the left main to the LAD. So 4 into 24 des was positioned from the ostium of the left main to the LAD stent, overlapping the LAD stent, and removing the all the wires, and it was deployed. After this, the post-dilatation end port was done. The distal LAD was dilated with 3.8. median proximal LED with 3.58 and left main stent with 4:8. And then left main stent was recrossed with the xeon blue wire into the L6OM1. And studs were dilated with 1.510 and then followed by 2.5:15 balloon. And final casing inflation was done by using 3.5:9 balloon in both the vessels in stepwise manner. And after that, the proximal optimization with 4.5:8 NC balloon and austere flaring with the same balloon was done, and 16:18 atmosphere. Sorry, I could not show the final result. I think I can show from the
I think we'll stop now because we're just running out of time. The case is well done. The only thing is when you pass the wire in the LED, you didn't have a microcatheter support?
Yeah, I didn't have my microcatheter support.
You didn't have?
Mostly, I have paired with microcatheter somehow. So I use balloon support most of the time as a support, supportive.
I find it very surprising, no?
But I don't know why. Most of the time, when I use microcatheter, I have paired many times. So. Balloon support, I have always found it useful.
Okay. Few comments. In choosing LED versus RCA, which one to do first? Generally, I personally choose RCA first because if it fails, we still have the option of sending for surgery, convincing the patient again. Or the instability is usually less because, as you said, there is a circumflex disease also associated with it. And whenever we take an RCA CTO, I think AL1 is much better, way much better than our JR catheters, because JR by default has absolutely no support. So unless you have a type A lesion, it is extremely difficult, or unless you have a conus branch that can have an anchor, but in your case conus was supplying LED and that cannot be used. Right. So AL would have been a much better
AL,
choice.
Would it cause compromises the coronal branch with deep seating of the AL?
Yeah, it can.
Yeah.
Before the coronal branch, there was not much disease. Mm-hmm. RCA was quite big, 3.5.
AL could have caused more ischemia because it would have gone deep and we could not have manipulated.
Oh, so what you in a situation like that, you can just keep a wire in the conus. Yeah. This will prevent the guide from going across the conus. Instead of putting a balloon, just a wire can keep this, but still the guide will be more coaxial than a JR. The other thing is, in that RCA, finally PDA was still not open, no? It was, you had centered into PLV.
We lost that branch because of that dissection and thrombus formation there.
Okay.
And since patient was hemorrhaging not stable, so we didn't even try after stenting the RCA. So we just finished the procedure and…
Okay. Now, since you had an occluded LAD, PDA would have been much more important for your LAD procedure than stenting into PLV. That's why. Okay. And why did you change into cyan blue in between?
Which side?
You said you changed to cyan blue, no?
On RCA.
LED.
LED, we changed to cyan blue because the Filter XT wire, after doing the dilatation, we usually change to the workhorse wire and we are using cyan blue as a workhorse wire.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. I think
thank you.
Very good
thank you.
Case discussions, and we'll close this meeting. I want to thank all the presenters for doing a wonderful job.
Excellent cases. Thank you.